Everyone, welcome to Friday, baking on Friday. We are making Bakewell tarts, or a single Bakewell tart if that's what you've chosen to make. I happen to have a big tart tin or pie tray, so I will be making one large Bakewell tart. Now, if you don't have a large tin like this, you can also use little individual tins I have somewhere, or you can use a muffin tray. So you don't have to have it's stuck in there. Get back in. Squish the door closed, it'll be fine. If you don't happen to have a pie tray or a sort of shallow dish kind of like this that you can make your Bakewell tart in, feel free to make little individual ones in a muffin tray. It's exactly the same thing. I will show you as we go along what you will need to do if you would like to make individual Bakewell tarts. I'm making one big one simply because I've never made one before and I quite like the idea of having a nice big slice of Bakewell tart. So that is what I'm going to do. Now, we are using a Mary Berry recipe today. So if it goes wrong, we can blame her. I've never made it before. This should be fun. I made the Jaffa cakes before and they still went wrong. So what bad could happen? We're in this together, we're gonna stick together, and we're gonna make ourselves a delicious Bakewell tart. I hope you're all well. Thank you for tuning in and watching. Project Keep Me Sane. Keep all of you sane as well. As we all know, yesterday they announced that they are going to extend the lockdown for another 3 weeks. Feels like it's been longer than 3 weeks, but we can survive this. We've survived this long. Another 3 weeks is not going to make any difference. All that it means is I need to think of some more things to bake. So send in your ideas, post your recommendations and things that you would like to bake. I already have a couple of things in mind for next week. One of them is a bread flour free donut. So that's what we're going to make next week. I've got a really good recipe for a Greek style donut that doesn't need any bread flour. I had an absolute spaz this week worrying about not having enough bread flour. And my wonderful, beautiful sister Laura managed to get me some. So I now have bread flour ready for baking focaccia tomorrow. But while I was thinking about the fact that some people might not be able to get bread flour, I found this donut recipe for flourless donuts. Well, bread flour free donuts, so that's on the list for next week, as well as a Jamaican ginger cake, which was requested by young James, my fireman friend. So what you will need for today is to get your oven heating up to 180 degrees. It's already starting to get warm in here. I'm slightly regretting my choice of large cardigan for this bake. You will also need a pie tin or flan tray, as it's sometimes called, or a muffin tray so that you can make individual Bakewell tarts. What I want you to do is give your tray tin of choice a very light greasing with some butter. Now, it doesn't actually say that you have to do this on the recipe, but I'm kind of thinking we do. You don't want to put all this hard work into the perfect Bakewell tart just to have it stuck in your tray. Now, do you? That would be a disaster. So give your tins a very light greasing with a bit of butter. Pastry is normally quite good because it's quite a high content of butter in the pastry. Generally, it doesn't stick to the tin, but let's not have any risks today. We had a pretty risky day yesterday with Jaffa cakes, so we're not gonna take those risks today. Hello everyone, hello Eve. Hope everyone is well on this lovely Friday afternoon. Let's get baking. So the first thing we need is flour and butter. And we need chilled butter. So I've just whipped my butter out of the fridge. We need nice cold butter for our short crust pastry. Now, short crust pastry, you would not believe, is so easy to make. It's the easiest thing you can probably make, apart from scones. Scones. Hi Kate! Kate Perks is watching. Hello to you as well. So, all you need to make a really nice short crust pastry is butter, flour, and a little bit of really cold water. So we're going to start with our pastry. Hope everyone's well. Hope everyone's following along. I've got my video up and running with my comments so I can see if anyone's having a massive disaster. Always like to know. I can probably help you, maybe, if I want to. Sneaky. Right, now then, start with our short crisp pastry. We need 75 grams of chilled butter cut into chunks. So I'm gonna cut up my butter in the packet into little chunks before I put it into my bowl. Makes things a little bit easier. We only have to weigh it once that way. So I'm just chopping up the butter in its little packet and I'm gonna put the squares into my bowl. 75 grams of butter is what we need. 75 grams of butter, chilled and cut up into chunks. Wayward butter. There we go. 75 grams of chilled, and I'm using unsalted butter because we're not going to be adding any sugar to our pastry. It is better to use unsalted for this. We don't want a savoury pastry. 75 grams of chilled butter cut up into chunks and plopped into our bowl. Ooh, nearly. 72, 73, it's so exciting, 80, great, you knew that was going to happen. Remove a little bit of butter. We want to be quite precise with this recipe. As it's the first time I've made it, don't want to go too rogue on it, you know, can't blame Mary Berry if I haven't followed the recipe. So, 75 grams of butter into our bowl. Then we are putting 175 grams of plain flour in on top. 175 grams of plain flour on top of our butter. In you go, plain flour. 175 grams. Perfect. 176, but you didn't hear that from me. Just thrown my flour, it's just spun across the table for some reason. Right, now, my hands are nice and clean and washed, fresh. All you want to do now is rub your butter into your flour. You can also use a fork for this if you don't want to get your hands dirty. So all you want to do is rub your butter into your flour. And it's as simple as it sounds, using kind of a rubbing motion. We want to break up the butter and blend it into the flour. I'm using a fork, so give it a good forking if you would like to use a fork, and just fork your butter into the flour, just like so. Just using this kind of motion to almost mash your butter, I would say. It, you know what, just use your hands, it's much easier. Get your hands in there, rub away that butter. It's much quicker to use your hands. We don't want to spend too much time on this because we don't want our butter to melt. This is one of the reasons why we're using chilled butter, is because we don't want it to melt. We don't want it to go all mushy in our flour because it's going to make our short crust pastry not very crusty. It kind of goes a bit rubbery. More like a kind of a, some sort of a biscuit if we let our butter melt too quickly. So here we are, rubbing away. We want it to resemble breadcrumbs when we're finished. So just keep rubbing your butter into your flour. As I say, I'm using one large pie tin because I'm making one large Bakewell tart. Now, when I was younger, all I knew of Bakewell tarts was Mr. Kipling's. So I never knew you could make one large Bakewell tart. Hence why I thought I would give this a whirl. Bit of a new recipe, but I think they would be quite nice as individual things. Something nice to gift to people, little Bakewell tarts. I didn't have any, never know how to say it, glass cherries. I don't have any of those cocktail cherries to decorate them with, because that was always the iconic thing about Bakewell tarts as well, was the nice little cherry on top. I do not have little cherries, but I do have a buttload of icing sugar, so I'm going to decorate mine with lots of icing sugar. And you can also use flaked almonds because this is essentially an almond flavoured dessert. We are using ground almonds in our filling, and I think you're supposed to use cherry. Like, this recipe asks for raspberry jam, but I kind of feel like it's always a cherry bake one. So if you could get hold of cherry jam, that would probably make it like properly authentic cherry bake one. At the moment I'm making, well, I've got a bit of raspberry jam, I've got a bit of blackcurrant jam, so it's kind of a black raspberry bakewell. Right, now, my mixture is in a nice breadcrumb consistency now. As you can see, it's quite fine breadcrumbs. There's no big chunks of butter in there. Nicely broken up, but that butter hasn't melted. Now, I'm going to give my hands a rinse. Get all this butter and flour off them. And then I want you to get a little bowl or a jug of cold, ice cold water. There we go. Clean hands once again. And we're going to get a little jug of ice cold water. You want your water really, really cold. So if you've got one of those fancy water dispensers on your fridge where it comes out freezing cold, that's what you want. A little bit of ice cold water. And now all we're going to do is go a tablespoon at a time, adding a tablespoon of ice cold water to our butter and flour breadcrumbs. Now we're going to start off with 2 tablespoons. I'm using my spatula. I'm going to mix that water in until my mixture comes together into a soft dough. You want to use as little water as possible, really. You don't want your mixture to be sloppy in any way. It's going to cause you lots of problems. I've just added 2 more tablespoons of cold water. So that's 4 tablespoons all together at the moment. And we want to work this into a dough. So I'm doing my best to kind of press my mixture together using that water that I've put in to get it into a dough. Mine is still very breadcrumby and quite dry. So I'm going to add another tablespoon of cold water. And we're just going to carry on like this until it creates a soft dough. Don't add too much water because you really don't want a sloppy dough. It will cause you more problems than an unset jelly. That's right. Okay, now I think I need probably just 1 more tablespoon. See how mine's, it wants to come together, but it's still quite crumbly. 1 more tablespoon. Of water going on there. As I say, take it a tablespoon at a time. If your mixture is coming together quicker than mine, then don't add any more water. Work it together with your hands or with a spatula until it starts to form a dough. It is coming together. I don't want to add too much. I'm going to add the tiniest dribble, like 1/2 tablespoon. Of water onto that, and that I think will do. Now, your mixture in your bowl might still be a little bit separated when you're using your spatula, but as long as it's starting to come together, that will be okay to work with. Keep your water to hand in case you need it, but we are going to use this dough now and see how we get on with it. As I say, we don't want to add too much water because our dough will go very sloppy very quickly. Now, using my hands, I've just brought that together into a ball, and that's perfect. See if I can show you that again. See? Use your hands, work it into a little ball, and then we are going to flour our surface very gently and turn our dough out onto our work surface. A little bit of plain flour on there, stop it from sticking. There we go. Perfect. And we're going to turn our dough out. Lovely. So there's your shortcrust pastry, basically. Hopefully you can see that. Just butter and flour and a little bit of water. So what we're going to do, we're not going to handle it too much. We're just going to make sure it's come together into a nice workable dough, because we want to roll it out now into a size that will fill our lovely tray. Now, if you've ever watched Bake Off, which I do religiously, you'll know that the key to any sort of perfect pie is a really, really thin crust. You want the pastry as thin as possible without breaking. And that's generally what you're looking for. But pastry is tricky. And the thinner it goes, the harder it is to work with. So you've got to try and get a balance. Mine is looking ever so slightly crumbly, but it is holding together, so I'm not going to worry too much. I'm going to keep turning it and rolling it. That's a good tip for rolling out pastry. For one thing, flour your rolling pin. Bit of flour on your rolling pin, bit of flour on your work surface, and roll. And if any of the bits at the edges go crumbly and want to break off, just press them back in to your pastry and roll this. It's holding together all right. I'm just going to like press the edges together because they're starting to kind of separate and crumble apart. Use my fingers a little bit to press them back in. And we're going to rotate and roll. It's a good technique to use. Keeps it unstuck from your work surface. The rotate and roll method. And we're going to just keep going until it's the good size to... Woo! See, don't let it get stuck to your rolling pin. Make sure your rolling pin's well floured. You want to go until it's a good size to fit our tin and it's not too thick. Rotate, making sure it's not sticking to the surface, and roll, roll and rotate. It's a good little motto, isn't it? Now this is nice and thin. It's holding its shape, holding together, and it's a good size for my tin as well. So I am going to stop there and I'm going to show you another little trick to put our pastry into our tin. You have your trusty rolling pin that you have just rolled your pastry with. We're going to put it in the middle of our pastry and we are going to gently lift our pastry and fold it over our rolling pin, like so. So I just put my rolling pin in the middle of my pastry. Then I folded my pastry over my rolling pin. And now all I'm going to do is pick the whole thing up using my rolling pin to lift the pastry instead of my hands. Because my hands are warm and it's going to melt my dough. So we want to not handle our pastry too much. I'm going to get my tray ready. Pie tray, flan tray. And I'm going to lift up my rolling pin with my pastry. And just lay my pastry into its little tin using the rolling pin to kind of roll it in. Et voila, just like this. Now, all we need to do is press our pastry into the tin. What I want you to do to help you with this is take a little bit of your pastry from the edge, something that's not going to make too much of a difference to the shape of your pie, our little Bakewell tart, and make a little ball of pastry, and we're going to use this to help us press our pastry into our Bakewell tart tin. If you are using your muffin tray or you're doing individual Bakewell tarts, what I would do is find a cookie cutter that's bigger than your muffin tray. You want something that's quite a lot bigger than your muffin tray holes, kind of like this. You can use maybe a bowl or a mug, something like that. Make sure it's bigger than your muffin tray. and cut out circles of your pastry using this cutter. Then your pastry will be the perfect size to then drape into your muffin tray and gently press into each muffin hole. Muffin hole! What we are going to do with our big dish is we're going to use our pastry, we're going to lift the edges of the pastry like this and gently press it in. Press it into the base of the tray. We lift up our pastry so that it doesn't tear as we're pressing. Now mine has this nice beveled edge to it as well, my tin. So I'm pressing my pastry not only into the bottom of the tin, but I'm also using my little ball of pastry to press the pastry into the edges of the tin. We want it solidly into the bottom of the tray, but we also want it nicely pressed into all of the edges as well. Just like so. If you use your ball of pastry rather than your fingers, it tends to keep the pastry in shape, stops your fingers from puncturing the pastry as you go around, and it stops the heat from your fingers melting your pastry as well. So just keep going, take your time with this, be gentle with your pastry, because we don't want to create any holes, we don't want to have any mishaps with our pastry at this point. We've done well, we've made short crust pastry, we've managed to get it into the tin, so try not to create any holes if you can manage it. If you do make any holes, just use a little bit of pastry to patch up those holes. Short crust is really good to work with. It's quite adaptable. You can piece it together, you can repair it as you go along if you find any little gaps and things. There we go. Pressing my pastry all the way around into those little beveled edges. See, I've got a little gap there just at the side, so I'm going to use a little bit of pastry from the other edge and just press it into that little crack that I saw appearing there. Don't want any cracks in my tart, do I? No cracks, please. Press the pastry into the edges, all the way around your tin, like so, making sure it's right into the corners. You want to make sure that your pastry is filling every little corner of your tin, because pastry tends to shrink as it cooks. And if you haven't filled the tin already, it's going to create a problem when it shrinks. Right, now, as you can see, I've pressed my pastry into all the little cracks around the edges, made sure that it's all nicely pushed into all them little ridges, but I've also, as hopefully you can see, left the excess pastry hanging over the edge, and there's a very good reason for that. As I've just said, your pastry will want to shrink, and if you cut all of this off now, what happens is your pastry starts off perfectly on the edge of your tray, and then as it cooks, it shrinks down, leaving us no room to fill it up with filling. And we want plenty of room for all of our lovely Bakewell tart filling. So what we are going to do is we are going to leave this with the excess pastry across the edges resting in the fridge. Be careful, because if you've got a loose bottom tray like mine, as soon as you put your hand on the bottom of the tray, the bottom's going to come out. So I'm going to make a little bit of room in my fridge. Make sure I've got a free shelf in there. And I'm going to place my tray with the excess pastry draped over the edges into my fridge. And it's just going to rest in there while we're doing the rest of our bits and bobs. Okay, now, the other thing that you will need for this recipe when we are blind baking our pastry is you will need some sort of either rice or dried pasta. Ooh, there's rice leaking everywhere. Dried pasta, or if you happen to have them, baking beans. Baking beans are like dried beans that you can pour in, because we're going to need them to blind bake our pastry. Once our pastry has rested, what we are going to do is line our pastry with baking paper or foil. We're going to put in some rice or some dried pasta if you've got it, like little shapes of pasta, or beans, dried lentils or pulses, anything that you've got like that, that you can pour in that's not going to change or do anything crazy in the oven. We need something like that to weigh down our pastry as it blind bakes. Because otherwise, if we leave our pastry blind baking free, it all puffs up and we don't want that. So, see if you can find yourself some rice, any kind of rice. I'm using basmati rice because that's what I happen to have in my cupboard. But you can use anything that's dried. But you can actually get baking beans, like a dry little stone kind of bean, but dried pulses or like quinoa or whatever you've got that's similar to that in your cupboards. Get a bag of that out so that it's ready, because we will need it. Right, now we're leaving our pastry to rest. We've got our oven on the go at 180 degrees. I'm going to turn that up a little bit so that it's at 200 degrees. So turn your oven up to 200 degrees. 180 degrees is if you've got a fan oven. So 200 degrees, 180 degrees if you've got a fan oven, but if it's a conventional oven like mine, put it up to 200 degrees. It needs to be a little bit hotter than we would normally have it for a cake. And we're going to have a little dance while we wait for our pastry to rest. Roll my sleeves up. And we have a little bit of a tidy round. I've got a great song for you today. I've seen a lovely lady and her two beautiful daughters singing this song. I think they're from New Zealand. It was on Facebook. Oh no, I can't remember the name of it. Alexa, play Elvis, Clap Your Hands. Alexa, volume 10.
Come on, everybody, by Elvis Presley, starting now.
It's so much fun. I love this song. I heard it this morning. Driving Jim mad singing it. Come on, Alexa, play my song. Clean up your areas, people, so that you're ready for the next stage. She did say she was going to play it, didn't she? Alexa, play Come On Everybody by Elvis.
I can't find Come On Everybody by Elvis in your music library.
Well, can you just play it anywhere? Alexa, play Clap Your Hands by Elvis.
Come On Everybody by Elvis Presley on Amazon Music.
Finally!
Come on everybody and snap your fingers.
Careful, I don't whole song or I'll get in trouble by Facebook. Right, so now we can start preparing our filling. What I want to do is give our pastry a little bit of time to rest in the fridge because we need to get it in the oven and start blind baking it. It's only had a couple of minutes. Make sure my oven is at the right temperature, 200 degrees. And also, it gives you a little bit of time, if you are making individual Bakewell tarts, to get your Bakewell tarts ready, your pastry, because it probably would have taken you a lot more time than it took me to get all your individual pastry discs into their little holes. So we're taking a bit of a leisurely time with it today. Let's prepare our jam, why not? Whatever jam you are using, as I say, Bakewell tarts are supposed to be cherry Bakewells, but I don't have any cherry jam, and Mary Berry told me to use raspberry, so I'm going to go a bit rogue, and I'm going to use some blackcurrant and some raspberry. I'm going to put a tablespoon of each in, because all we need this jam to do is line the bottom of our pastry. Give it a nice jam layer. So I'm doing a spoon of raspberry and a spoon of blackcurrant. I'm going to mix the two together. Get a bit of a hybrid fruit on there. Raspberry and blackcurrant, why not? Give it a bit of extra flavour. I suppose you could really use any jam you like, couldn't you? Could use some of Steve Hay's homemade strawberry jam. I'm quite a good boy making jam. Oh, that gives me an idea. We could make fudge. Couldn't we? I know how to make fudge. I could show you all how to make fudge. It's a lot more simple than you think as well. You don't need like a thermometer or anything. I can show you that. So yeah, next week, I'm looking for some ideas of what people would like to bake next week. I've got my bread flour free donuts. I've also got Jamaican ginger cake, gin. I was thinking of maybe a lemon meringue. We've learnt meringue. We're learning pastry today. So why not learn how to make lemon curd and put them all together in a lemon meringue pie? Or maybe one of Jim's favourite desserts is key lime pie. We could do both. We've got 6 days worth of baking next week. Why not do all of them? Let me know what your favourite cake is and I'll see if I can add it to my list. There we go, our jam's prepared. While we're waiting, we may as well get that prepared as well. Now, my pastry has only been resting for about 7 minutes, but I'm going to take it out and I'm going to put it in to blind bake. Now, as I said to you before, your pastry will shrink as it bakes. That's one of the reasons why we left it to rest, because it shrinks. Now, one of the other things that we're going to do to try and stop that is what I mentioned to you about your rice or your baking beans, putting them in while it bakes. The other thing that we need to do to stop it from fluffing up is use a fork and we're just going to stab our pastry. This is going to stop any air bubbles being created in our pastry as it bakes. We don't want any bubbles puffing up. We don't want it to puff up like puff pastry. We want it to be nice and short and crispy. Shortcrust pastry. So we stab some little holes into it to stop it puffing up. And then I might rest it, in fact, back in the fridge while I prepare my lining. We're going to line it. I'm going to use baking paper. You can use foil, but I've only ever used baking paper for this kind of thing, so I'm going to stick with that. I'm going to show you a little tip with your baking paper that I have shown you before. I'm going to cut a sheet of baking paper that is plenty big enough to fill my tray. I'm going to make it square just so that I don't have too much excess going into my oven. And then what we're going to do with this is we're going to scrumple it, screw it up, scrunch it into a ball. Just like that. I'll take out all your anger on the paper. We need it. Come back. Oh, right. Scrunch with your paper. Definitely getting warm now. this cardigan was a bad choice. We've scrambled it up, and this makes it a lot more pliable and mouldable, because we're going to put this into our pastry, we're going to fill it full of rice, and we're going to get it in the oven to part bake. So, blind bake, as it is called. Bring my tray out again. But the pastry's sinking. What is she doing? She keeps putting me in the fridge for no reason. Right, putting my baking paper in and gently, gently pressing it into the base of my pastry. And then I'm going to fill it chock full of rice. I really do need to get myself, you can actually buy purpose-made baking beans for precisely this reason, that you can reuse. I'm not sure if I'd be able to cook this rice once it's been weirdly baked in the oven. Probably could, probably just have like a bit of a baked flavour to it. Now what I want you to do, if you're using rice or pulses or something other than beans, is I want you to concentrate all of your rice into the corners. Make sure none of your rice is touching your pastry. It should all be within whatever you've used to line your pastry, so your baking paper or your foil. And I'm just pushing my rice into the edges, because this is where we want to make sure that it stays in shape. And basically, it's just to weigh it down. Now, the only other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take my scissors, and some of the areas where there's a quite a large chunk of pastry hanging over, I'm just going to chop them off. I'm not going to take it all the way to the tray. I'm just going to take the larger pieces that are hanging over and chop them off. This just makes things a bit tidier while it's in the oven. It's still going to have enough there to help us with the shrinkage, but just makes it a little bit tidier as we're going along. And then maybe we can use that pastry for something. Make some little pastry biscuits or something like that. Right, there we go. Pastry is ready. Chop that bit off as well. And that's going in to blind bake for about 10 to 15 minutes. So your oven should be at 200 degrees now. Mine's just under. Pop it in the middle of your oven to blind bake. I'm not sure why it's called blind baking. It's not as if pastry can see in the first place, is it? Right then, that's been on the floor. Pop that in the bin. And our extra pastry, don't like to waste anything, so I might bake that in a little bit. Little biscuits, cover them in sugar. Little sugary bits of pastry. Hi Jean, how are you? Are you baking along today? Say hi everyone. This is a nice leisurely baking session. We've got things to wait for, things to do. We're not having to rush through. Right, now we can really prepare our filling. We've got our jam prepared. All I've done is kind of give it a little bit of stir in a bowl so that it's ready to go when we need it. Now, we are going to make our filling. What we need for our filling is softened butter, caster sugar, ground almonds, and eggs, one large egg. And what I'm going to do, because you just saw me take my butter out of the fridge because it needed to be chilled for our pastry, so I am going to warm up my butter in the microwave a little bit because it needs to be soft for our filling. So we need 125 grams of butter for our filling. So measure out your 125 grams of butter into your bowl. If it's already soft, don't worry about warming it up. Just needs to be nice and soft. Ooh, 125 grams of butter going into our bowl. Oh, look at that, perfect. Perfect amount. Love it when that happens. 125 grams, and I'm just going to soften it. About 10 seconds in the microwave. And while that's going, I'm going to get out my electric hand whisk. The whisker. Because we are going to soften our butter with our whisk and cream it with our sugar. So I've got my whisk ready. Got my slightly softer butter. Does doesn't need to be melted, just soft. And we're going to whip this up with our sugar. So get your electric hand whisks ready. You can use a conventional hand whisk if you like. Doesn't need too much power to get this whipped up. How long to blind bake? About 10 to 15 minutes. So let's set our alarm for 10 minutes. And then we'll have a look at our pastry and make sure it's surviving in there. Should be at 200 degrees, your oven. Oh, I think 10 minutes will be perfect, but it says 15, so we'll just check it after that. Right, 125 grams of butter. This is our filling. It's called frangipane. I don't know why I find that thing. Frangipane, that's right. So we're putting in 125 grams of butter, soft butter. We're putting on top of that 125 grams of caster sugar, and we're going to whip this up into a frenzy before we add our egg. 125 grams of caster sugar in on top of there. Hope everyone's well. I hope the news of 3 more weeks of quarantine aren't depressing anyone too much. I was kind of sad about it and kind of not. I think I just kind of, we knew, didn't we? We knew that it wasn't going to be all lifted and fine in just 3 weeks. We couldn't possibly have hoped for that. So I wasn't surprised, but I'm not going to lie, it wasn't the best news I've had all week. Whip up your butter and your sugar. My butter is still a little bit cool, so it's taking a little bit of time to mix into the sugar, but that's fine. Yeah, so I wasn't completely shocked, but yeah, I was secretly hoping that maybe this would possibly resolve a bit sooner than that. But to be honest, you know, another 3 weeks takes us to the start of May. 7th of May takes us to, just before the bank holiday weekend. So if we're all allowed out by then, you never know. Big bank holiday weekend parties and all sorts of other wonderful things that we can look forward to. My butter is wanting to jump out of my bowl. Stay in the bowl, butter. Possibly should have softened it a little bit more. So you're whisking up your soft butter and your sugar. You want it to all incorporate together before we add our egg. I think I might need my egg to get my butter to soften it. Right. Hasn't quite mixed all together yet, but I'm going to add my egg to my butter and my sugar. If you're not very good at cracking eggs, I would crack your egg into a separate bowl first, just to make sure you don't drop any shell in there, because it'll be quite tricky to get the shell out once you've added it to your butter and your sugar. That's our one egg's gone in there, and we're going to whip that up into our butter and our sugar. Make sure that's whisked in well, and all of our butter and sugar is mixing well with our egg. Should be nice and soft and fluffy, just like so. Mixture off my whisk. Make sure that we don't miss out on any of this. There is an extra little thing that you can add if you happen to have it in your cupboards, and that is almond extract. If you have any almond extract, you can add it at this stage to your sugar and your butter and eggs that you've just whipped up. Gives it a little bit of a punch of extra flavour. I don't have any, so I'm not using any, and I'm sure that it will be just as scrumptious without it. Scrumptious? I don't think I've ever used that word. Scrumptious? What is that? Scrumptious. It'll be just as scrumptious without it. But if you happen to have some almond extract in your cupboards, why not add a teaspoon of almond extract and see how much of a difference it makes to the flavour. Give it a little bit of a punch of almond. Right then. I've just scraped all of my mixture in there. Don't want to waste any of that mixture. And now I'm going to measure my 125 grams of ground almonds in on top of that. And we're just going to mix it together with our spatula. So we want to take out my spatula, disrupt the weighing. 125 grams of ground almonds. I'm not sieving them. We don't have to worry about chunks. 125 grams of ground almonds going in on top of that mixture. And you're just going to mix it all in. Doesn't really need the electric whisk for this. You can use just a spatula and give it a good stir in. You're just making sure that all of your almonds are well incorporated into the butter and sugar and egg. And it should make quite a nice creamy paste, just like this. Oh, it smells very almondy. You know what I might add? I don't have any vanilla flavouring either. The only flavouring that I have is this caramel. I might put in a drop of caramel flavouring, why not? It'd be a caramel frangipan with almonds. There we go. So yeah, if you've got any vanilla maybe, pop a little bit of vanilla in there or whatever flavouring you might happen to have and want to give a go. Almond or vanilla, I put in a little bit of caramel flavouring. And that, essentially, is our frangipan. That's it, that's all it is. Almonds, butter, sugar and egg. Ready to rock and roll. We're doing really well, you know. We've got our... Oh, what's going on? My egg was a double yolker. Nice. Just makes it a bit richer. I wouldn't worry. How's everyone doing? Yeah, 10 to 15 minutes for your pastry. We've put our timer on for 10 minutes. And we're going to check it after 10 minutes, as usual. Don't want it to overbake at this stage, because it's got to go in again once our frangipan goes into it. I think it's had about 6 minutes so far. Let's have a look. Where's the timer? I've put down my timer and I can't find it. First one, I found it. Right, so it's got 3 minutes left until it's had 10 minutes in there. I've got like bits of butter and sugar that have flown out of the bowl. Mix them back in. Don't want to lose any flavour. Fab. There we go. Put our weighing scales to one side. So this, essentially, is your filling for your bake pole tart. We have jam that we are going to spoon onto the base. We've got a frangipan filling. Our pastry is in to blind bake. All is well in the world. Should we get another song on? There's another song that I wanted to play for you all. I heard it this morning on Joe Wicks. Alexa, play Ollie Murs, Dance With Me Tonight.
Here's Dance With Me Tonight by Ollie Murs on Amazon Music.
Thanks. Ollie, let Joe Wicks play it. Ollie, if you're out there, please let me have the song so that I can dance to it.
Thank you. We've got a trick or treat for you today.
Ollie,
I'm going to call my friend.
Strip it off, everyone. Strip it off.
Since you leave.
It's for Ollie.
Let's go, man.
Yeah,
I feel the music moving through your body.
pastry, my pastry, has had 10 minutes in the oven. In our cooling tray out. So it's had 10 minutes. It's messy. Keep your hair tidy, I said. It's had 10 minutes in the oven so far. Now, what we need to do with our blind bake is we need to have it in there for just over 10 minutes. Then we need to take out the beans or rice or pulses or whatever it is that we've used to weigh down the pastry and pop it back in to dry out a little bit. So that is exactly what I'm going to do. We don't want a soggy bottom now, do we? Clean up my area. And I'm going to take out my tray. Oh, look. They've had a wash. Nice, clean oven gloves. I'm going to take out my pie, my pastry. And I'm going to take the rice out of it. And then I'm going to pop it back in the oven. Right. Oh. There's my tray. Whew, now, here we go. Pastry's out. It's had just over 10 minutes, it's had about 12 minutes. I think that's plenty. Now, this is always tricky. Getting the rice out of the pie. Now, my rice doesn't look too brown. I've done it before and the rice goes like a really dark brown colour. This hasn't, so I'm going to keep it and I'm going to use it as food because we can't be wasting food these days. Right, there we go. Rice very expertly removed. Take your time with this, be careful. This is the point where we can take off our excess pastry because it's already had some time to shrink. It's already shrunk a little bit around the edges, and now we can make a nice clean edge that's going to bake and go nice and brown, and nobody will ever know that you left it on there. I'm going to take a knife, I'm going to use a different knife. Try to use a straight edge knife, not a serrated knife. It will make it a lot easier. I'm going to use my tray, and I'm just going to run my knife gently around the edge of the pie tray. Just like this, and it's going to just trim off. Ouch, it's hot. I bet scissors would be better actually. Let's use scissors. Oh, scissors, nice and clean. Use your scissors to go around the edge and just trim off those extra bits of pastry that we left on. Don't worry if they kind of crack and crumble. As long as the pastry that is in your tray is nice and straight, that is all you want. So just carefully go along the edge, trimming off the excess pastry. There we go. Don't worry if it's not perfect, because we can tidy this up again later on. Trim, trim, trim off all that pastry. Make sure it's nice and tidy at the edges. Scissors work great. Don't use a knife, use scissors. We've got some good kitchen scissors. And then we're going to put this back in for another 5 to 10 minutes to dry out the base. Because our edges, you'll see now, our edges are nice and crisp. But the base of our pastry is still a little bit soft and uncooked. There we go. Pastry edges trimmed to perfection, just about. Still got a few little extra bits on there. Trim those away gently as I go. And then we're going to pop this back in our oven for another 5 to 10 minutes to dry out the base. Right, we're doing well, everyone. Our pastry's looking good. Whoa, look at that. Base of our pie, perfection. Open the oven, whack it in, and set your alarms for another, I'm gonna say 8 minutes. Let's go 8 minutes. And we just wanna try and dry out the base. But at this point, we don't want our pastry to burn or go too brown. Try your pastry. It's just plain butter and flour, but it tastes really good. This is why, oh my god, I'm going to dip it in the jam. Why not? Delicious. Right. Keep my tray handy, because I'll need that in a minute. I might keep these little bits of pastry as well, because they're a tasty little snack. Yes, they are. Right. Nothing goes to waste, people. I'm keeping all of this. It's weird, isn't it? Like, all this rich food that I make, I bake a lot of, like, stuff that's full of sugar, full of chocolate, really rich stuff, lots of extra flavourings in there, and sometimes I just crave something plain, like a cracker. It's like, I want to fancy a cracker. Or rich tea biscuits are great for that. A little bit sweet, but generally quite plain. Right, there we go. Our pastry is doing very well, baking away in our oven. Something's burning. I think I might have dropped a bit of pastry into the flame at the bottom there. Oh well, nice smell of burning through my kitchen. We've got our frangipan ready to put into our pie base. And we've got our jam. Now the other thing that you could probably do with to make your frangipan application a bit easier is a piping bag. Because we're going to put jam in the bottom, then we're going to layer our frangipan on top of the jam. And it's kind of like, a paste. So we don't want to like lose our jam. But I'll show you a little tip how to get it evenly layered, even if you don't have a piping bag. But if you happen to have a piping bag, whip it out, because it will make your life a lot easier. All you need to do, if you have a piping bag, is fill said piping bag with your frangipan, and then later on, when we're putting our frangipan onto our jam, just pipe it on in little circles and spread it out. Just saves it from getting messy and spreading into the jam too much. Right then, have a little tidy up again. I'm concerned by the burning smell. There we are. A little bit of crust just dropped onto the bottom of the oven and started to burn. Right then, we could have another little song, another little dance around while we're waiting. Why not? What should we have on? Woo! I like the Elvis one. Can I play the Elvis one again? 5 more minutes left. Alexa, play Elvis, Clap Your Hands. It's not what it's called.
Here's Come On Everybody by Elvis Presley on Amazon Music.
Thank you. Come on, you gotta do the moves.
Come on everybody and snap your fingers.
I'm never in time.
Come on everybody and clap your hands real loud. Come on everybody, take a real deep breath and repeat.
Deep breath.
This tune right now.
Soon, and there they can't, but never fear, they'll be back next year with the same show, All Shook Up, at the Core Theatre in Surrey Hall. So if you fancy going to see Boo Elvis next year, I believe it's in April, but I'm apologising if I've gotten that wrong, go and watch a bit of All Shook Up, the Elvis musical. Oh, right. This is the time when you can take a breather, make yourself a cup of tea if you like. You've got 3 minutes until we have to fill our frangipan into our tins. Down. See, I love this. I love it. People are watching, they're not even baking. You do not need to want to bake to watch these videos. These videos, the reason for them is twofold. Number one, keep me sane. Number two, keep you sane. Well, three as well, teach you something. The general idea is so that when we come out of isolation, we can think to ourselves, you know what? What a crazy, weird, mad time we were living in. But I've come out of it and I know a little bit about baking. I have learned a lot as well, not just you guys. I've never had to teach anybody to do anything before. I'm not a teacher, and I've had to learn how to break down recipes to show you how to do them. I've learned some recipes that I've never done before. This is one of them. I have never, ever, ever made baked pot tart before. So this is a first for me. I have learned how to make baked pot tart with you live on Facebook. Lots of things. You're doing well. Even if you're just watching, you are absorbing knowledge as we go along. It's just good fun, isn't it? You can watch me. I wish kind of, sometimes I think it'd be funnier if I made more mistakes. But I'm just too good a baker. If anybody watched the Jaffa Cake video, there was a lot of mistakes made in there. And if you didn't, go back and have a look. It was hilarious. My jelly slid right off my Jaffa. But these things happen. Today is going well. We've got edible and very tasty pastry. Baking in the oven. We've got frangipan, which looks a dream. I mean, I don't know how frangipan is supposed to look, but it smells lovely. It smells very almondy and delicious. Kind of looks like, well, it looks like runny butter, I'm not going to lie. It looks like mushed up butter, which is technically what it is. But I'm sure that's exactly how it's supposed to be. Our jam is lovely and jamming. I might try and make my own jam. I mean, basically, it's just fruit and butter, sugar that you just boil away, so it can't be too hard. Oh yeah, shall I tell you, so tomorrow, Saturday, losing track of what day of the week is, Saturday tomorrow, which means we are going to be making bread. Now, whenever we make bread, it's always like a two or a three part process. This one will be a three part process. We'll be making our dough, we'll be shaping our dough, and then we'll be baking our dough. So if you would like to make focaccia tomorrow, the recipes are up on the group. Have a look at what you need. Essentially, all you need is bread flour, yeast, water, and olive oil. Then whatever flavour that you've got, you can just use a nice sea salt, chunks of sea salt. We're going to be doing garlic and rosemary. So if you fancy making a bit of bread, you do need bread flour, and it has been really hard to come by. So I apologise if you haven't been able to find any bread flour. But even if you haven't, watch the video, learn a little bit about making bread. And then when we come out of this craziness, you can come back and try making your own bread at home. It's very rewarding making bread. Hell of a long process, but very rewarding. Right, now. Woo! I think our pastry is done. The blind bake may be completed. Let's take it out and have a look. My hands are protected. Right. Oopsie. I'll tell you what. Meant about the shrinking. Pastry has still shrunk away from the edges ever so slightly. I possibly took my rice out ever so slightly early, but still good. We've got a good shape here, a little bit of browning around the edge. Bit of puffing, this is what forking our sponge was going to alleviate, this kind of little bit of puffing up. Got a bit of crumbly crust in there. Right then, away we go. What we need to do is we need to spoon on our jam onto our pastry base and spread that out. I'm using about three tablespoons of jam, and you want to get it right up to the edges. Mine's got blackcurrant jam in, so there's some little lumps of blackcurrant in there. But that is absolutely fine. It will only add to the flavour. Make sure you've got a really good coating. So that's, how many spoons is that? Should I put on three or four? All you need is to make sure that you've got a really good layer of jam right up to the edge of your pastry base. Smooth it all around so it's nice and even. The jam's done, everyone. There we go. Mine is raspberry currant. Or blackberry. No, black raspberry. Right then, now we are going to put our frangipan on. Now the thing that worries me about putting the frangipan on is that it's quite thick and I don't want it to like mush into my jam. I want to keep a nice separated jam layer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use 2 tablespoons like this and I'm going to drop tiny blobs of frangipan around on top of the jam. This is going to get an even layer of frangipan and make it easier for us to spread it out without kind of mushing it into all the jam. This is where it would be very handy if you had a piping bag. If you have a piping bag, you can just pipe circles of the frangipan filling all around your base so that it's nice and even. And then when you come to spread it out, you shouldn't get too much mushing of your filling. This was something that my mum taught me when we used to make shepherd's pie. This is how she used to put the mash on top of the shepherd's pie so that it didn't sink into the meat. I mean, it's not a great thought while we're making a sweet dish thinking of shepherd's pie, but you know, it's nice to know where you learn all these things from. I learned pretty much everything I know about baking from my mum. And she learnt it from her mum. And in this day and age, when you can learn pretty much anything you want to know online, I quite like the fact that I've got kind of first-hand knowledge from a human being that's been passed down generation to generation. My mum even has a cookbook that her mum used to use when she was a little girl. And it's got markings in it that my mum made when she was a child, even before she knew how to read. Markings in this old cookbook of things that she liked. It's a proper old school book with like all your flans and old measurements and all sorts of good stuff. Adding butter and grease to everything was a must. No such thing as a healthy recipe. And I remember when my mum was making out her will. She was like, what do you want? What shall I leave to you? I was like, I just want the cookbook. I'm not too fussed about anything else. Can I please have the cookbook? Because I can then make recipes, the same recipes that my mum and my nan used to make when they were young. Right, now, we've used all of our filling now in this way of spooning little blobs. And as you can see, I've got quite a good coat covering already. And now I'm just going to gently join together all of the coating. See, if we were just doing one massive blob and trying to spread out one massive blob, we would be in a right pickle right now. So taking your time with this stage will pay off. We're already getting like ever so slightly amounts of the bleeding of the jam up into the frangipan, but it's all going to taste good, you know. We don't need to worry about it. It's still going to taste good, and all we need to do is have a nice smooth layer of frangipan filling all the way up to the edge of our pastry case. Nicely evenly spread, like so. Take your time. Don't be too aggressive with it. It's going to slip and slide around a bit, but that's absolutely fine. Make sure that all those gaps are filled in. Don't let your jam to sneak up to the surface. You're going to get your frangipan right up to the edges. I like these. Lovely jubbly. There we go. Pretty level. I'm happy with that. Got a few little blobs of jam up there, but you know what? It's going to taste good anyway. Ta-da! A frangipan can now go in the oven. Gloves on. Whoa. Come on, pie. Don't misbehave now. And in it goes into the oven. Now, we're going to leave that in there. Ooh, it's hot. To bake for 15 minutes. 10 minutes, but it's most likely going to need longer than 10 minutes. But never fear, we are here and we can check as we go along. So, let's see how everyone is getting along. How's everyone doing? Any questions? Any mishaps so far that I need to know about? Bam, 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 bam. No, I'm just refreshing. Refreshing my list. Okay. I think we're all good. No comments is good comments, I think. Make sure we're all doing well. Da, 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 da. Yeah, we're good. I think so, yeah. Right then, we can tidy up again. What song shall we have? We can't have Elvis again. Maybe something else from Elvis. Alexa, play Jailhouse Rock, Elvis. Elvis. By Elvis Presley. And eat some of your pastry and jam. Because I said so. Alexa, volume 10. Tart. Then put a tablespoon of frangipane in each one, smooth over the top, bung it in the oven. Simple as that. You haven't missed anything, Roo. We've just made a Bakewell tart, but really you haven't missed much. How was your nap? Did you have a good nap, Roo? This is the thing. What a great life. I mean, really, how can we complain? My life is generally wake up, do Joe Wicks, moan about life, bake at 3 p.m, have a nap. That's what I do. Tell a lie, I do a bit of singing as well as I go along. Small, I don't know, how do you pronounce the thing? Smally, small, schmall, who knows? It's an app where you can sing remotely with your friends. I mean, they must be making a fortune because there is that many videos popping up. And it's one of those therapeutic things as well, singing. And it's a lovely app because you can actually sing with other people without having to be anywhere near them. The app puts your voices together. I mean, it's not always perfect. Sometimes the time is a bit off, but it's great. So that's what I do. Wake up, do Joe Wicks, have my breakfast, deliver cake to people. I have to say that is my good deed generally, delivering cake to the world. Moan about life. Can't miss that. It's on the schedule. Moan about life. Nap, bake, maybe nap again. Might shower, might not. What is there to complain about? No money, forget about that. It's not a problem. As long as I've got money for ingredients, what more do I need? My wonderful, fabulous, lovely family have been super helpful, and my lovely friends, dropping off wonderful things to me. Chicken, me and Jim have been eating a lot of chicken lately, thanks Donna. Donna also made me this fabulous pinny. Donna Rhodes. Woman of many, many talents. Very talented woman. So, yeah, I mean, we can't really moan about life, can we? I hope your nap was good, Roo. Anyone else been doing different things lately? Learn anything new? Learn a new language? Learn how to have an afternoon nap? Can be tough. Still busy licking the bowl? Ooh. You know, I haven't tasted it. I mean, it's mostly butter and egg. Does it taste good? Not bad. It's basically butter and sugar and almonds. I mean, what's not to like? Ooh, that caramel flavouring that I put in is quite strong. I'm going to have a caramel Bakewell tart. That sounds amazing. Caramel Bakewell tart instead of cherry Bakewell. Put a layer of caramel on the bottom. Drizzle it with chocolate. Millionaires. Frangipane. You see the good ideas that come out of these things? I'm going to now amuse you all by trying to put rice from a big bowl back into a small bag. See how it goes. It's gone well. It's gone really well. Why did I do it? Why? I knew it wasn't going to work. It's foolish, foolish behaviour. Right. Our tarts are going to need about 15 minutes. Well, they're going to need long. They're only about 20 minutes. So we're just going to leave them in there. We're going to leave them baking away. Let me know if you fancy this song. We're going to have a dance around the kitchen. I'm going to vacuum my floor again. There's a lot of rice on the floor. Put that in the bin. Using this voice. This is my list voice. We're making lists. Do this, do that. Bow, 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 whatever. Alexa, play something else from Elvis. Volume 10. Oh, Alexa, volume 10. That's Simon Says. Alexa, play Faith by Stevie Wonder.
Faith, from Sing Original Motion Picture Soundtrack, isn't included with Prime, but is available with Amazon Music Unlimited. Play over 60 million songs with Amazon Music.
I do not
music.
Need, thank you, Alexa.
It's free
Alexa,
for 30 days.
Stop. Let's keep it out. Alexa. Alexa. Play Cher. Thought she was annoyed with me there.
Shuffling songs by Cher.
I don't know what I'm doing,
Amazon
Alexa.
Music.
Stop talking to me. Fireman Jim, been off at work working hard. Oh, then he has to come home to me. Crazy me. Ooh, 10 minutes has gone by. Let's have a look in our oven, because what else do we have to do? Nothing. Let's have a look in our oven, everybody. Come with me, everyone. Whoa, don't fall over. Oh, yes. See how it's kind of, it's all spread out. It's covered up our jam. I can't see any jam on the surface. I think that's a winner, you know. I'm quite excited about this. As I say, I've never made this recipe before. I've never, ever before made Bakewell tart. Today is a first for you, as it is for me. We're together in this. Oh, it's hot over by the oven. I feel my face going red. Right, now, the only other thing that we really need to organise for this recipe, make sure that my oven is at the right temperature, needs to be at 200 degrees, is we need to prepare our decoration. Now, I don't have much in the way of decoration. What do I have? Let's have a look. I might find something marvellous. Nope, nothing in there. Nothing. So, oh, candied peel. No, not in that oil. Okay, so, all I'm going to do is whip up a bit of an icing sugar topping for my Bakewell tart. Or what I know of Bakewell tart is mini tart, jam, frangipane, icing sugar, proper layer of icing, cherry on top. So I don't have the cherry on top, but I can do the layer of icing, can't I? So I'm just gonna put a whole load of icing sugar in a bowl. That's a technical term, everyone. Technical measurements. A whole load of icing sugar into a bowl. Let's open this up. Woo! Cher is still warbling away in the background, she does. Let's have some more ABBA. Alexa, play ABBA. Can't go wrong with ABBA. I'm going to put two heaped tablespoons, well, let's make it three. Three heaped tablespoons of icing sugar. And I'm going to put in, let's say, 2 tablespoons of water. 1 tablespoon, 2 tablespoons. And I'm going to mix that up, and that's all there is to it. Alexa, volume 10.
I don't want to talk.
Alexa, volume 1. It's too sad. Can't be listening to sad music. It's one of those things we avoid. Oh, I have.
Here's a playlist you might like. R&B to Wallow to on Amazon Music.
Don't interrupt me while I'm talking to my cat. Alexa, volume 1. We can play R&B, that's absolutely fine. Now I'm going to need more icing than this, so I'm going to put in some more icing sugar and a bit more water. But while we're baking, I thought I'd give you some actual positive tips on how to keep yourself sane during these sad and uncertain times. If you are not working, like what I am, it is very important to have something to fill your day with that will make you feel in some way or another worthwhile. For me, it's baking. It's the only reason I get up in the day. It's something that I can be held accountable for. And that is quite important, really. You need to be like held accountable to something so that, you know, you can, if I don't get out of bed, I know that you guys will all miss me baking. So it forces me to get out of bed. Alexa, stop. So it's important to have something, even if it's like a call with a friend. Timing a call with somebody, or a FaceTime, or a little chat, or even like a text message with somebody, so you know that every day, if you don't get up and call that person, they're going to be wondering where you are. They're going to be wondering what's going on. It's a good little tip for keeping yourself going. Another tip, and now this one, is really quite important, and I feel like everyone should take this into account. Limit yourself. Limit the amount of news that you watch. Limit the amount of news that you watch. This was something that my sister works for, a really amazing company, and they have been brilliant in looking after all of their staff. Really have. I'm amazed by what they've done. They sent out a thing, my sister kind of had to lead the project in giving people tips on how to keep their mental health going while we are stuck in isolation. And this is one of the things they said, limit the amount of news you watch. Because it's not healthy. It's not healthy to be watching. Most of the news is negative. Limit the amount of news that you watch. And also limit it to something that you know for a fact to be true. There's far too much negative and untrue fake news out there. That's why it's called fake news. Untrue news out there. So I limit myself to watching the daily Downing Street update. That's all I get. That's all the news I watch. I actively avoid looking at any other kind of news. On Facebook, when it pops up, I just skip past and watch a silly video or a TikTok or something like that, or something baking, and limit myself to just watching the Downing Street update, because I know for a fact that that is true. Even if people are like conspiracy theorists and all of this and you have ideas about what's going on, I just wash off all over that. Just forget about all of that. Watch Downing Street, I know that's true, and stick to that, because otherwise you're going to get very carried away with things that aren't necessarily true and get yourself upset over nothing. So that's a great tip to have. Now, I've made myself some really relatively thick icing here. You see how thick that is? And that is going to be my topping for my baked bao tart. It might be even a tiny little bit too thick, I think, because we want to be able to kind of pour it on top and have it a good coating on there. So I'm going to add a couple more drops of water. This is all, literally, icing sugar and water is all you need for your topping. If you haven't got anything else, if you've got some flaked almonds maybe, or cocktail cherries, or something else that you want to use to decorate your bakewell tart with, you could even just put a dusting of icing sugar on top. That always looks nice. Much better. Slightly runny icing sugar topping. There we go. How runny should... Oh, I'm glad you asked, Kate. This is how runny your icing sugar should be. It depends what you're using it for, really. I'm going to have a thin coating of solid icing sugar all over the top of mine. Or you can use it as kind of a drizzle and just drizzle it like so. If you're drizzling, I'd say to have it a little bit kind of thicker so that you get a nice thick drizzle. This is how runny mine is. I have no idea how to test the viscosity of something. The viscosity is the thickness. I'm sure there must be some clever physics way to test the viscosity of a liquid, but I don't know what that is. Dun, 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 dun. Oh yeah, there's great programs on as well. Fill your time and watch. We've got so much time at the moment to watch things, to watch TV, to watch films. So fill your time, fill your mind with positive things. Watch a bit of comedy. If you're feeling down, put on a nice happy film and cry through a happy film. Why not? Gino De Campo, Gordon Ramsay, and the French guy from, is it First Dates? One of those. Are going like around the world doing a cooking program. Apparently it's really funny, so have a look at that. Phil and Holly as well on The Breakfast. They're great. Love a bit of Phil and Holly. Oh, you know what? Come look at our pie. I think our pie is done. Look, it's all brown on top. That looks done to me. Can't even tell you how long it's had. I'm so sorry. I've neglected you all. I think it's had about, I'd say it's had about just over 20 minutes, maybe 25 minutes. It has had in the oven and it's ready to come out, everyone. While we were chatting away, we completely forgot about our baking. It happens to me a lot. Right. Oh my God, that looks amazing. I mean, I know that, it's me saying that, but look at that. Ooh. Uh-oh, it's just the thermometer. Right, that one's going off. It's too hot in here anyway. Oh my gosh, that looks lovely. And it smells amazing. Bake on top. We've got a nice golden brown top. It's a little bit of a darker brown around the edge. We've got some kind of cracking and separation on top, which I'm sure we're probably not supposed to have, but it smells great and it looks great. And when I cover it in icing sugar, no one's going to see the top anyway. Let's tilt that down. Can you see it? Look. See? Bit of extra browning around the edge. It's got some kind of, yeah, little cracks and whatnot and a few little bubbles, but looks pretty good to me. I mean, it's going to smells good. It's going to taste good. I'm going to cover it in icing sugar anyway. What I'm doing now is a very technical part of baking, and it's called nibbling the edges. And I'm just tidying up the edges of my pastry by eating them. There's a better knife. I'm just going to use a little knife to tidy up the edges of my pastry. I mean, this is really unnecessary because nobody's going to be judging this apart from Jim. Jim's actually quite a tough judge, I'm not going to lie. I was obsessed with Bake Off a couple of years ago and I wanted to apply. So he gave me tasks to do, different things to make, and he would judge them for me. And he's a really tough judge. He was very critical, but it makes you better, you know. I'll take some criticism. Our Bake Off tart is finished, everyone. Look at that. Whoa. Katie Davies watching. Happy birthday, Katie Davies. I know it was the other day, but it's good all week. Katie Davies, 21, everybody. She's living the high life in isolation, but it's going to be fine. All that means is you get to celebrate your 21st birthday again when we come out, and probably again after that. Right, Bake Off tart. I'm not sure whether to let it cool before I put my icing on. Yeah, why not? Let's put it on there. No, I'm going to let it cool. Let's be serious about this. I'm going to let my Bakewell tart cool, and then I'm going to cover it in icing sugar, my drizzle that I've just made, and I'm going to find something to decorate it with. Maybe I'll decorate it with a bit of lemon zest, or it's got to be something I can decorate it with. Maybe I'll just write my name in it instead. I could draw a cherry. Draw a cherry with something. There we have it. Me and you, we have just made a Bakewell tart. The last thing I'm going to do before I leave you is I'm going to take it out of its tin. What am I going to do with this? I'm going to take it out of its tin and pray that it holds up. This is another little test of a good pie. Is you want it to come out of its case perfectly. So that's what we're going to try and do. I've used a little jar. It's a loose bottom. And we're going to just slide it onto the cooling tray like this. This looks good to me, everyone. Look at that. We use a spatula and try and slide it off this base tray. Out. Perfection. Oh, hopefully you haven't got a soggy bottom. I won't know that until later. Woo! Into the kitchen sink it goes. But look, it holds up. It's a bit wibbly wobbly. Bakewell tart. So when it's cool, I'm going to pour my icing sugar all over that. And I shall show you what it looks like once it's sliced. Thanks for baking along, everyone. I hope you've had a good day. And I will see you tomorrow when we are making focaccia. We'll be starting at 12 noon tomorrow, not 3 p.m. So if you want to make focaccia, tune in at 12 o'clock tomorrow lunchtime. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you have a lovely day and a lovely weekend. And I love you all. And I'm all about the love. And love, 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 love. Bye.